He works in web security at the NS Security Lab, and he's going to talk about how to make the mobile web faster. And I'm pretty sure it's going to boil down to less cat pictures, all. Less cat pictures. So let's get a big round of applause.
Yeah. Good evening, Inyan. Good evening. I'm Inyan, and I'll be talking about why the mobile web is slow and what you can do to make it faster. So, yeah, there have been a lot of studies which show that the website loads very slowly on your mobile phone. Even though users expect that the mobile website loads as fast as their desktop website, or sometimes even faster, the ground truth is that this has always been a problem and the websites don't load as fast. So let's see why websites are slow on mobile devices. So the major factor why this is the case is because of much higher latencies on mobile devices. So in compared to your desktop computers or your laptops, your mobile connection can have much higher latency. So even if you are on a 3G connection, for example, the latencies can be as high as 500 milliseconds. This means that it can take up to 500 milliseconds for a data packet to leave your mobile device, reach the server, and come back to your phone. So if you have even, say, 30 resources on your web page, that itself leads to around 50 seconds in delay, and 15 seconds is spent in the latency of your website. Another aspect which can be a bottleneck in when your page is loading is the bandwidth that is available to you. This doesn't matter as much as the latency of your data connection, but in the towards the lower end of the spectrum where you have 2G connections or edge networks, this can be a performance killer, especially if you have, say, a lot of content-heavy websites or a lot of cat pictures on your website. And battery is another major factor that you need to consider. So the mobile operating systems do a lot of things to optimize the battery of your mobile device. So one of the major things that they do is to keep the network radio at a state of idle for the most of the time. So this is because if it's in an active state for the most of the time, then say your battery wouldn't even last even an hour. So there is this idle state that the network radio is on, and it can take up to 4 seconds for it to fully reach the active state, and then your mobile starts downloading at the maximum possible download speed. This again doesn't matter as much if you're using a desktop computer. Again, and the browsers itself have much lesser resources on your mobile phone to play around with. So they have weaker CPUs, lesser RAM, and lesser storage. So even if the desktop browsers can optimize the web page by caching aggressively, so Chrome, for example, aggressively crashes your web pages to give you a better experience on your desktop website. But in the mobile, it's not as much possible because there is lesser RAM and lesser storage. So that actually wraps up why the websites are slow on mobile part of my talk. And for the rest of the talk, I'll be talking about what you can do to improve your performance of your website. So there are a lot of aspects to performance of your mobile website. The first category consists of the various components in your web application. This can be your CSS, images, fonts, JavaScript, and so on. I've just mentioned a few libraries that you can use to optimize each of these resources next to them. And the second component is how you deliver these resources onto the client or the mobile device. So you can use newer transport protocols like the HTTP2, compress your assets using gzip, put them on a content delivery network, tune your TCP stack, and so on. So as you can see, this there's quite a varied set of things that you can do to optimize your web page. And yeah, I can't cover everything in this talk. So for this talk, I'll just be focusing on JavaScript. So if you have this script file that you have written something to do something on your web page, let's see what are the different ways in which you can load the script file onto your page, and what are the performance implications for each of them. Yeah, so you have the script file, and the simplest way is to obviously just put it in a script tag and load it in a page. But then you see that, okay, Google has released this new shiny new JavaScript framework in I/O this year, and you definitely want to use it, so let's throw in that as well. But this framework doesn't work on older browsers and IE9 and some other mobile websites. So let's put a polyfill, which polyfills the functionality for these older devices. And let's throw in jQuery, because your Stack Overflow also says that jQuery is the most awesome library, and let's do it. But yeah, you can see where I'm going with this. So quickly, your simple JavaScript file becomes all this Reactified, Minified, blah, 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 JavaScript file. And it becomes very complex. And yeah, from the browser's point of view, this is a lot of work for the browser to deal with. So it needs to send a request for each of these JavaScript files, get the response, and then execute it in that particular order. And this is a problem, especially on mobile devices, because we just spoke about latency, how that is a performance killer, and that this itself at least requires 4 round-trip times to the server, and this is a problem. So the most obvious way to solve this problem is just to combine all of these resources into one huge JavaScript file, and now there's just at least 1 round-trip time to the server. So the latency problem is solved, and you decide, OK, everything is good. So you open up your browser, then you notice there's something wrong with this approach as well. So to see what is wrong with this approach, we need to understand a concept called critical rendering path. So without all the jargon and with informally, it just refers to the minimum number of resources that is required by the browser to display something on the screen. So for this HTML page, let's see what happens. So the first critical resource is the HTML page itself. So the browser has to download the HTML page. And then it begins parsing this HTML page into the DOM. So it, when it reaches the script tag, it pauses the DOM construction, does resolves the DNS for your server, makes does the TCP handshake, downloads the JavaScript file, and then begins to execute it. After it's done executing, then it continues the DOM parsing. And while all this stuff is happening, the user is just seeing a blank page on the screen waiting for some content to come. So after this, when it actually reaches the content of the page, then the user sees the content you wanted him to see. So the main point here is that JavaScript blocks DOM construction. The simple reason is that in your JavaScript file, you can query the DOM to find out the various attributes of, say, an element. And if it doesn't block on DOM parsing, every time you load the page, you might get inconsistent behavior because the DOM parsing happened parallelly to JavaScript execution. To prevent this, the browser mainly blocks on DOM parsing. And because of that, because of the DOM not being parsed, it can't render anything onto the page as well because the browser needs the DOM to render something onto the page. So the easiest way to get around this is to don't put your script tag on inside the head at the first, right at the start. You just put it after your content, right? So this way, the browser starts parsing the HTML file, gets to your content first, so that's good. So the user sees some content, and then your JavaScript kicks in. So this JavaScript, again, blocks on DOM construction, but it doesn't matter because there's nothing left to pass after the JavaScript file anyway, so that's good. And it prioritizes your content, so you're happy. But yeah, we have forgotten about CSS. So let's see what happens if you include a CSS file in this page. So now the DOM parsing, when the DOM parser reaches the CSS file, it sends off a request to your CSS file. Now it can continue parsing even before the CSS file has come in because CSS does not pass on the pause DOM construction. But JavaScript pauses on DOM construction. And you can see if, say, suppose this combine.js file is in your cache, and you can execute your JavaScript immediately. But there's one more property of JavaScript, that JavaScript also blocks on CSS. So it's the same reason, basically. So JavaScript can query the style attributes of any element at any time. So the browser needs to ensure that all the styles declared before the script tag has been applied onto the page to ensure consistent behavior. So yeah, this is the main problem with loading your script this way. It blocks on existing CSS resources. So can we do better? So you would want a way to load your JavaScript which does not block the rendering of the page. And you also do not want it to block on any existing CSS resources. Browser vendors have sort of realized that this was a problem, and they have given us a way to load your scripts asynchronously. Before we go ahead and say that, OK, I'll just go and async all my scripts, there's a problem with this. So the very first way in which browsers introduced to let you defer your JavaScript execution is using this defer attribute. So you just add this extra attribute onto your script file, and things are good. So it was introduced as part of the HTML4 standard. The good parts about this is that the rendering of your page is not blocked, so your DOM construction can continue happening even though it reaches the script file. It does not block on CSS again. And the order of the scripts is maintained. So this is important because everything is happening asynchronously. You need to make sure that your dependencies don't break at any point of time. So the only caveat here is that the JavaScript is deferred to just before the rest of the DOM is finished parsing. So even though your script file is already downloaded and ready to execute, the browser doesn't execute it till the rest of the DOM has finished parsing. So just to check whether if you're, all of you are there with me till now, so just like to see what happens if there are these two script files. Could you just tell me what the output in the console will be at this point? So I'm just attaching the defer tag at both of these scripts. In the first tag, I'm just printing 1, 2, and the second is 3. Yeah, OK, so the output is supposed to be 1, 2, and 3 because the defer attribute maintains the order of this order of the scripts. But however, IE9 decides to say it's 1, 3, 2, just for the fun of it. So what it does is that when it reaches, if a particular tag has the defer attribute and it's changing the DOM, it leaves the script at hanging at that point and goes and executes other scripts and then comes back to it after the other scripts are done. So this was a very stupid behavior that IE9 had, and basically you can't rely on this attribute for Internet Explorer 9. And it wasn't only Internet Explorer. So all the other, actually none of the major browsers agreed on how the defer attribute worked in some obtuse cases. So Mozilla published an article back in 2008 saying that it was the only one which was following the defer attribute like totally to the specification, and none of the other browsers were strictly adhering to the specification. And yeah, so some browsers like Safari and IE even behaved erratically when you reload the page each time, so you can never be sure of which script is going to execute before which other script. So yeah, you couldn't. So the implementation of this attribute is totally screwed up. So the browser vendors decided to do the next best thing. So they introduced another attribute as part of the HTML5 standard called the async attribute. It behaves slightly different from the defer attribute because yeah, there's no point just introducing the same attribute again, I guess. It has the same properties of defer in the sense that it doesn't block the rendering of the page and it doesn't block on CSS. But these scripts are executed as soon as they are downloaded. So it doesn't wait for the DOM to finish parsing before the browser executes these scripts. But again, you can't guarantee the order in which these scripts will be executed. So script 2 might end up getting executed before script 1. And that's a problem if you want to ensure that the dependencies of your scripts are being maintained. So what you want right now is probably a way to load your script without blocking the DOM, without blocking on CSS, somehow have a reasonable way of ensuring that your dependencies don't break, and execute your scripts as soon as they're downloaded. It doesn't wait for like DOM passing or something like that, as in the case of defer attribute. Turns out there is no way you can do this using HTML alone. So what do you do now? So of course, we use another script tag to load the script tag. So this is how you load dynamically load a script tag. In fact, Google Analytics for a long time has been using this way to load its analytics snippet into your page by dynamically creating a script element, attaching its source, and then appending it to the DOM. So the good parts about this is that it does not block rendering. It's executed as soon as it's downloaded. But again, this does not preserve the order. So you can tweak the script a bit to ensure that the order of the script is maintained. So you just set this async script.async equal to false. And then the browsers ensure that script 1 is definitely executed before script 2. And it doesn't block rendering of the page, so which is good. But that's always a but, right? So these scripts, which you inject dynamically through another JavaScript, still block on CSS. So it doesn't block on DOM parsing, but it still blocks on CSS. So that's a deal breaker again. It's the same problem as your inline scripts. And yeah, Safari 5.0 still doesn't recognize this async equal to false, and it just loads these scripts in any order it wants to. So if you are with me till now, these are the different methods for script loading that we have discussed till now. So these are just the 5 methods. And you can see none of them is a perfect way to load the script you want, which is completely async. None of them is completely async in that sense. So we have tried to come up with a method which sort of solves all these problems to some extent. We had to do it through JavaScript because there's no easy way to extend the functionality, like add a new tag or something without modifying the browser. And that's, of course, not feasible. So we tried to do this via JavaScript. And what we have done is try to build a dependency graph of your scripts. So what we have done is we take in your web page, automatically analyze it to figure out the various, to find out which scripts are dependent on which other scripts. So in this case, script 2 is dependent on script 1 because it's using a variable that is defined in script 1. And there's also this functional dependency which can exist. So script 4 is dependent on script 3 because it's making use of a function which is there in script 3. Once we get these two graphs, we merge these two graphs to form the final dependency graph, which looks something like this. So once we have this graph, we are able to parallelly download all the roots of these graphs. So we parallelly initiate the download of script 1, script 2, and script 3. And once any of the scripts has finished loading, we automatically notify its neighbor so that once the neighbor's dependencies have finished loading, they can start executing as well. The good thing is that it does not block DOM passing, and we sort of infer the dependencies of each script so your page doesn't misbehave. We have also run this tool on some websites to see how it performs. So this is just a demo video on how it behaves on the ESPN website. On the right, you can see the optimized page. We are trying to optimize the first render, so it doesn't block on scripts, so it loads within 5 seconds, whereas the original page, which we haven't done any changes to, loads in about 10 seconds. So yeah, we have tested about around 80 sites in the top 100 Alexa sites, and we have found that we are able to increase the first render time on a 3G connection by up to two times or three times, depending on, decrease the first render time on all of these websites. So the main advantage of doing this is that it prioritizes the content that you want to show the user. So that's what they came in for. So it's better if you show the content upfront. And the another advantage is that two independent scripts can be downloaded and executed without, so even if one script fails to load for some reason, the other scripts which is not dependent on the script can go ahead and continue executing. The main disadvantage with this method is that in some cases you need JavaScript to render something onto the page, and we are deferring that critical JavaScript that's required. So if you are using some JavaScript framework which to do the, to dynamically add elements to your DOM and stuff like that, in that case this approach won't work as well. And there are some scripts which introspect on the web page itself. They try to find out how many scripts are there in the page, and behaviorally if we try to add more scripts or defer the execution of the script. So those, there are some problematic scripts in that sense. So the main thing that we are trying to advocate here is the policy of progressive enhancement. So the user has come to your web page to see some content, so you can just show him the content upfront instead of asking him to wait for JavaScript, CSS, and all other resources to load fully. So the better way to do this would be to just inline your critical JavaScript and CSS that's necessary, so that the user at least gets the feeling that the page is loading without having to wait for too long. So you can see that some apps like Facebook and so on do this. They just load a template, which is basically the menu bar and so on, to give you a feeling that the page is loading and the server is not down or something like that. You don't need a huge JavaScript library or, say, a lot of JavaScript to show just some basic HTML content onto the page. So the idea here is to just show content on the page, and JavaScript comes in later. JavaScript style sheets come in later and enhance the web page further, depending on the network state and the mobile device the user is using and so on. There are some other crazy hacks to load your script files as well. I won't go, if you're interested in me discussing any of this, I can discuss it. But yeah, there are other crazy ways, but it's not very standardized on how you load the script files. That's about it, I think. Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter, and I can take any questions right now. Yeah. Yep. So this is exact. Okay, so his question is, what happens if a script that you're including in a page fails to load, and what should happen in that kind of case? Am I right? Yeah. So this is exactly what I've been trying to say. So your page should not be only dependent on one particular JavaScript file. So there should be no single point of failure. So there might be some clients, for example, who disable JavaScript entirely onto the page. So doesn't mean that you show a blank page to them or say that, okay, enable JavaScript. You should show your content upfront, and JavaScript is the sugar that you add on top of the page to, you know, further enhance the experience of your users. So even if your JavaScript fails to load for some reason, your network is down or the server is down, you should at least show some basic content onto the page, and then if it loads, then it's good. You can add in your fancy stuff onto your web page. Yeah.
If you combine all your scripts into one JavaScript file, which method is the best to use?
Yeah, if you combine it into one, I'm assuming that you combine it in the proper way, so then the order doesn't matter. It's the best method would be to put your JavaScript at the bottom of the page and then async it and put the defer tag as well. The problem with this method is that, again, it blocks on CSS, so if there's any CSS files, then it's a problem. And this is going to be a huge JavaScript file that's going to be, the browser can't start executing the JavaScript file till the entire JavaScript file is loaded, so it needs to wait for the entire file to be loaded, and then it starts and passing and then executing it. So those are the main two disadvantages if you have this huge JavaScript file. It's better to split your scripts into smaller pieces in that sense. And with newer technologies like HTTP2, if you use that, the round trip times to the server doesn't matter anymore. So you can, all of this is multiplexed and sent to your client as soon as possible. So that's a better way of doing that. Yeah.
No,
oh.
You answered my question.
Oh, okay. Any other questions?
You have your dependency graph, and you figure out the nodes, the roots, and then you load those JavaScript files parallelly.
Yeah.
Okay. So have you done some sort of benchmarking on how many sites actually have crazy dependencies? And so because the bottleneck is if the design is in such a way that they're independent, then your method should ideally perform the same as
you're saying if all the scripts are totally independent of each other.
Right, like a small website.
Yeah, if all the scripts are totally independent of each other, then it works the same way as just adding the async attribute.
Right.
But in some websites we saw there are three, four subgraphs that we found in each website. So there is three different trees which you can start processing parallelly. And if you put the async tags on all of these different nodes, then the dependencies will break, of course, and it will lead to incorrect behavior.
Have you done some experiments?
How many graphs that are formed in each? No, we have the data, but I can't tell you the number right now about how many graphs have been formed. It typically ranges from either one, which means that all the scripts are dependent on each other. There's a single line of dependency, and sometimes in some websites we have found there are three, four subgraphs which can be loaded parallelly.
And how expensive is your graph construction?
It all happens offline, so this dependency analysis is pretty heavyweight, so it doesn't happen immediately. So our tool takes in a web page, and we assume that you do this analysis beforehand, and then we can inject our module loader or whatever you call this tool. With the help of a proxy or whatever.
And then you like some sort of cache instance.
What?
How do you during runtime when a new web page comes in, like something that
Yes, so we one way in which we can deploy this is to have a proxy server where if you get in a page, then we analyze it and send in the original unoptimized page back to the client, and once the analysis is done, then we can swap the cache or whatever and send the optimized page back. Okay, thank you.